Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Friendship Bible Church. We're glad that you're here, and we're glad that you're here online as well. We are looking forward to worshiping the Lord together on the 17th day of May. It's just an awesome, beautiful weather here in Florida. A couple of quick announcements. If you have a tablet, a phone, a computer that can connect to Wi-Fi, please. It'll interrupt our live streaming signal. So please make sure you're on airplane mode or your device is off entirely. It gives us a much smoother live stream signal. So appreciate that. Just in case you didn't know, Sunday school is back in session. And so 9:15 Sunday mornings, all ages, children through adult. Tomorrow night, Monday night, we have our deacons meeting, 7 p.m. And as a reminder, and it might be news to some of you, you will find at the end of your pews, I think on the aisle end, a paper Bible. And that's because with your phone on airplane mode, you're not going to have internet access to online Bibles. So there is a hard copy of the Bible available to you, and please make use of that. One other thing, and this is both an announcement and a prayer request. As most of you know by now, Lynn and I are approaching the horizon of our professional career, and about a year and a half from now, I can't believe we're even saying that, I'll be retiring. But it's retirement from pastoral ministry. We are going into a retirement ministry that we're calling Along the Way, where we're going to go alongside churches that are struggling and just need some help turning around and getting revitalized. And we're looking at that being a national ministry starting here in Florida, but going across country. To do that, we need a camper, and it's got to be a little bit bigger than the little 15-footer that most of you have seen. Well, the Lord brought a buyer to buy our camper. Our little camper is gone. We had a moment of grief. We had to weep some tears over an empty pad there. But right away, the Lord has brought to us the possibility of replacement campers for the same or less than we sold ours for. And so this afternoon, this evening, we may be traveling to take a look at that if someone doesn't snag it while we're in worship this morning. That's an announcement because we have valued as a church family that you are part of this process. We made a determination a long time ago. We weren't going to give you 4 weeks' notice and say, bye, we're retiring. We've been with you too long. We're too much of a family. So this is part of our future, and we want you guys informed and invested in it in prayer and support and hope and encouragement. So if you would pray for us, that the Lord would give us wisdom and discernment, that it would be whatever the Lord has in mind that you and we would sense that provision. We encourage that prayer support on your part, and we thank you very much. All right, we've got a missions moment coming. Are we ready to launch that? We are, so I'm going to hit some lights. So it is, thank you. Remember, this is our, this whole month, this is our Great Commission Sunday month, and this will give you some information.
Most of the people who faithfully attend the more than 2,000 CNMA churches in the United States have come to us from other theological traditions. And many of the 30,000 who each year come to faith in Christ in one of our fellowships have no church background at all. It's for that very reason that the CMA DNA series, Part 1, The Fourfold Gospel, and Part 2, Core Values, was developed and produced, designed for utilization in membership classes, small group settings, and a variety of other contexts. It is our prayer that we would be able to introduce and ground thousands of disciples, new and old alike, in these core beliefs and practices that have made the Christian and Missionary Alliance one of the most dynamic Christian movements of the last 120 years. I firmly believe that this series will be one of the most effective discipleship tools we have ever produced.
By the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. So that time we talked about how the reason for our worship was the mercies of God, and how the first half of Romans was building up and talking about God's righteousness and his grace. Paul starts off with his wrath and judgment on sinners, the righteousness of God, and how we have peace with God through faith in Jesus, our new life in Christ, freedom from the law, our position in Christ, our future glory, and how it all comes by God's grace and not of ourselves. It's God's free gift to us. And these are the reasons, among many, why we worship God. But how do we worship? Well, that's the next part of the verse, by offering our bodies as a living sacrifice. Okay, so what does that mean? We know in the context of Israel and the Jewish tradition, the sacrifice was the animals being sacrificed in the temple. But how do you do that as a living sacrifice, and how do you do that with us? What does that look like? And that's where verse 2 comes in, because verse 2 actually gives us an explanation of that. We read verse 2, it says, "Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect." So we're not to be conformed to the world, but we're supposed to be transformed. And the word transformed is the same word that was used of Jesus in the Transfiguration, how he was transfigured from the normal human-looking person into his glory that he has with the Father. Like manner, we're supposed to be transformed from looking like the world to looking like the people we are as adoptive sons of God and heirs together with Christ. So this is through the renewal of our minds. In 1 Corinthians 2:16 it says we have the mind of Christ. So we worship by knowing and doing God's will. So, how do we know that that is what our worship is? How do we know this is not just two commands? Worship God, and then don't be conformed to the world, but be transformed. And Paul ties that together with the very end of verse 2. He says it's the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. And those are words found in Leviticus 22 to describe acceptable sacrifices. So, testing and discerning, what is the will of God doing? And understanding what God's will is our worship. John says repeatedly, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments." And that is our worship. It's worship not just in our bodies, not just in our hearts and our minds, it's in our actions, it's in every aspect of our lives. So as we worship today, let us worship God for his many mercies. Let us worship him with our whole being. Let us worship him in the mind of Christ, in accordance with God's will. Lord, we thank you for being with us. We thank you for your grace that you have poured out on us in every aspect of our lives. Lord, mostly and greatly for the adoption of us as children of God, sons and daughters, along with Christ. being made at peace with you. Lord, as we seek to understand your mind, to be renewed by your Spirit through the reading and studying of your word, through prayer and your Spirit's guidance, may we worship you in spirit and in truth in every day and every action, in our hearts and our minds and our attitudes. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Please stand, brother.
Thank you.
going to receive the tithes and offerings. And just want to remind the people that are watching from home that there's three ways you can give. You can give at our website. Just click the donate button on the left-hand side of the front page. Or you can give by snail mail, good old U.S. mail, that works. And you can also bring your offering to the office and during office hours. We're there Monday through Thursday from 8 to 2. And if we're not there, you can just slide it under the door for that matter and we get it the next day. So three ways to give. We aren't having the ushers go up and down the aisles with plates as we normally do because we want to keep that 6-foot distance from each other as best we can and not pass that plate from hand to hand. So I just want to encourage everyone when after we have prayer, come down the center aisle towards the plates and you can give your offering that way and then make your way back to your seat by going around the outside. That way we'll keep everything flowing. Try and keep about 6 feet distance each other as you do that, and that's going to keep us all happy and safe, I suppose. I was talking to a friend of mine, and the COVID thing came up. He said, "I'm not participating." It was pretty interesting. But what else was I supposed to say about the giving? I think that's about it.
Thank you. Thank you for giving.
Yeah, thanks so much. You know, a lot of churches have taken a huge hit this time, but our giving has been pretty close on the line with what we normally give. I think we might have been bumped down a little bit this past month. I'm just kind of staring at our church treasurer right now. He's looking at me with this dead eye. But, okay, we'll see. We'll keep watching for the updates on that. But let's go now to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your faithfulness to us in physical things. And Lord, it's because of your love for us in spiritual things that we come to understand that everything we own really belongs to you. So we just want to honor you and worship you with a portion of what you've blessed us with financially at this time. And we pray you'd bless the gift and the giver. And we pray that you would multiply this offering for your use in your kingdom work. In Jesus' name we pray and give thanks. Amen. So yes, come. The other thing I was going to say, and I just remembered, if you're uncomfortable coming up, you can do that after the service, or you could hand your offering onto one of our elders or deacons or deaconesses, and I'm sure they'll help you get where it belongs. Thank you.
morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Today's kind of a special day. Don't go too far, Sarah. I'd also like to ask our parents if they would like to come forward. Do I?
Yeah.
Hold it too close, it sounds real loud, though.
That's what we want.
But anyway, like I said, this is kind of a special day. We're having our opportunity today to be able to present Sarah Pittman with a special award. And one of the reasons I asked our parents to come up, to if they have any words of wisdom or encouragement or anything that they would like to share with her. Would you?
Sure. If you all turn your Bibles to.
It's second.
Keep his mic up.
You know better. We used to meet with a family in Claremont to do a Wednesday night Bible study, the McIntyre family. They were it was a great time. One Wednesday night, Sarah came to know the Lord because their daughter shared Christ with her. The next day, I'm looking behind my recliner. Sarah and Samuel are down there. She's praying. She led him to the Lord. One day later, I would like to think that her Awana background had helped her because of the scriptures that Awana is based on scriptures. One of the best programs I've ever seen in the church. Helped her to understand. And from that point on, she's been using Awana, I think, to grow, but she's also been using Awana to teach other young girls and boys about the Lord through Scripture. God's powerful, isn't he?
Anyway, Sarah, I'd like to present you with this year's award. It's a citation award, which is given for completing all the material that they have in the Awana, hundreds of Bible verses and material that they have to study. This is not an easy award to win. It's not something just gifted to somebody just because you like somebody. You can't do that. You have to earn this thing. So I really do appreciate you. And the past year, she worked with Kimberly, that our last Awana year, that we had children. And her and Kimberly, they took care of our SMART program for us. And she did a wonderful job. And she was always willing to help and always willing to be there. And I do thank you for that. And I can see that God, according to your father and things that I've seen, your willingness to wanting to serve has definitely been God's. I can see God's hand in your life. And I do appreciate you, Sarah. Thank you, Lord.
York is coming at this time. We're going to have a prayer time for him and anointing with oil. He has had some hemorrhages in his eyes, and it's made it very difficult for him to get around and not driving. Jan's doing all the driving now. So just turn that over to Pastor Paul.
In face of the congregation, normally at a time like this, we would invite our elders to come down, but just out of respect for what we're going through right now, we're all here, and we all are the body of Christ. So as I lead in prayer, if you would just pray along and just ask the Lord to touch his body and bring healing to his eyes, we would greatly appreciate your prayer support there. Brian?
And wisdom as I go forward with the doctors working on my eyes. It's kind of scary. You get shots in your eyes and stuff like that. It sounds terrible. You don't even feel it. But, yeah, it's real kind of earth-shattering.
Yeah.
You can't see nearly as good, so.
And just so you know, and anybody online watching knows, we are grateful beyond measure for the medical society, the physicians, and all that's available to us in terms of healthcare, especially in this country. It's amazing what is available to us. But there is no healer like Jesus. And so as we come and we anoint you with oil in the name of the Lord, as we do this in obedience to Scripture, we do so asking that Jesus would reach down and touch and heal this man's eyes. And at the same time, taking no credit whatsoever away from the medical society and what they do. But Jesus can heal. Man cannot. We can make things feel a little better for a while, but Jesus can heal. Brian, we anoint you with oil in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. In obedience to Scripture, let's bow together in prayer. Father, we thank you so much for your servant Brian. We thank you that you called him into your kingdom and that he has served you many, many years faithfully. And Lord, you have given him very good health throughout these years. And now, for him to be struck with the inability to see clearly, not be able to drive, all of the independence that is put at risk because of this, Lord, it's a very uncomfortable place to be for anyone. We ask, Lord God, not because he deserves it, not because he's got anything special going for him, but because you love him, and because your death on the cross provided healing for the physical body. We ask in Jesus' name that you would heal our brother Brian, that you would restore his sight, that you would get all the praise and the glory, and that even in the medical field, they would have to just step back and say, we didn't do this. This came from somewhere else far beyond our ability. Lord, we thank you that you have provided healing in Jesus' name. And we come to you for this grace upon Brian's life. Lord, would you bless him? Would you touch him? Would you heal him? In Jesus' name.
Amen. And for Janet to put up with it.
All right, as I walk Brian back to his seat, Randy's going to continue. You got it? Okay. Randy's going to continue to lead us in prayer.
Let's go to the Lord now in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your great love for us. We thank you, Father, that no matter what our circumstance is, that we can rely on you. You are rock steady. You are our anchor. You are our fortress. You are our redeemer, our healer, and our God. And Lord, as we've prayed, we just ask for your healing touch on Brian York. Lord, we congratulate Sarah Pittman, and we thank you so much. This is no small achievement that she has made, and we just pray you'll bless her life, make her fruitful, Lord, lead her in the way that you would have her to go. We have several specific prayer needs that we've been told about, and we'd like to just raise up them in prayer. Pastor Paul and Lynn, we just pray, Father, in regard to this travel trailer opportunity, and if this is what you want them to have, that you bless them with that. And Lord, for every detail as they plan and as the time approaches when they would enter these retirement years, we just pray, Lord, that you would guide them and direct them and help them to be fruitful. Give them good health and strength, Lord, for what you have for them to do. Lord, we pray for Mary Taylor, a very special, personal, unspoken request this morning. You know what it is. And we just pray that you would move in the hearts of people that she's concerned for, and that you would bring about a great restoration, Lord. Father, we pray for Betty Bishop, 93 years old. She was taken to the hospital this week, and it looked very grim for a while, but you've returned her home, and we just thank you for your care for her, and we just pray for you to continue to watch over her and be with her during these difficult times. Lord, we pray for the many ministries of our church, and I'm reluctant to start naming them because I'll leave someone out, but specifically, we pray for Lake Swan Camp, with the cancellations that have occurred because of the COVID-19 pandemic, they are put in an awkward position. Lord, we just pray you'd restore all their workers and their reservations, Lord, that they'd be filled up, Lord, very soon, and that you'd meet the needs, the financial needs of their camp as well. We pray for the College of Missionary Aviation, Lord, having to do everything online right now as far as education goes is difficult. And Lord, we just pray for a boost in their enrollment very soon, Lord, that they'll be able to expand and continue to prepare missionaries for the remote areas of our world, Lord, where the gospel is still not thriving and hasn't been heard. Lord, we pray for our Sunday school program. We thank you that the adult Sunday school is now back in place, and we just pray you continue to restore all of our Sunday school program to all ages. We pray for American Heritage Girls. We pray for Trail Life. We thank you, Lord, for the way they're preparing young men and women for life and for ministry. We just pray, Lord, for the Gainesville Church plant, which has been put on hold as Gainesville's on an even stricter shut-in order. We just pray, Lord, in your timing, Lord, that work would be blessed, Lord. What a privilege it is, Father, to come here to fellowship together, and how we've missed it, and how joyful we are to fellowship in your spirit together. We just pray, Lord, for this time now together, that you would open our hearts as the word is opened, that you'd change us into the image of your Son, Jesus. In his name we pray and give thanks. Amen.
Thank you, Randy. And as you're turning in your Bibles to Esther chapter 3, a couple of quick things, testimony. Lake Swan Camp, while it's not, doesn't have any campers coming in yet, they have been able to rehire most of their staff, and so we rejoice in that. And our children's Sunday school is up and operational. We rejoice in that as well. And the College of Missionary Aviation has been able to re-engage now some of its flying program. So God is on the move and doing great things, and we rejoice in all of that. Also, I just want you to know, especially those of you watching online, we are aware this morning that Facebook has been having some issues with the sound, and that the signal has been in and out, but it seems to be stable now. So if you're watching online and you've stuck with us, thank you for your patience. Appreciate that. And this will be uploaded to YouTube later, so you can watch it in its unbroken entirety there as well. And always, the messages are available on our Facebook page, and you just click on the menu item that says, what is it?
It's on our webpage.
Our webpage. So you can go to our webpage and you can find the audio files for each Sunday's messages. We're in Esther chapter 3, verses 1 through 15, which is a whole chapter. We're entitling this one, Where Honor is Due. It'll become readily apparent why that title in just a moment. But let's go ahead and read this chapter together. After these events, King Xerxes honored Haman, son of Hammedatha, the Agagite, elevating him and giving him a seat of honor higher than that of all the other nobles. All the royal officials at the king's gate knelt down and paid honor to Haman, for the king had commanded this concerning him. But Mordecai would not kneel down or pay him honor. And then the royal officials at the king's gate asked Mordecai, "Why do you disobey the king's command?" Day after day they spoke to him, but he refused to comply. Therefore they told Haman about it to see whether Mordecai's behavior would be tolerated, for he had told them he was a Jew. When Haman saw that Mordecai would not kneel down or pay him honor, he was enraged. Yet having learned who Mordecai's people were, he scorned the idea of killing only Mordecai. Instead, Haman looked for a way to destroy all Mordecai's people, the Jews, throughout the whole kingdom of Xerxes. In the 12th year of King Xerxes, in the first month, the month of Nisan, the pur, that is, the lot, was cast in the presence of Haman to select a day and a month. And the lot fell on the 12th month, the month of Adar. Then Haman said to King Xerxes, "There is a certain people dispersed among the peoples in the provinces of your kingdom who keep themselves separate. Their customs are different from those of all other people, and they do not obey the king's laws. It is not in the king's best interest to tolerate them. If it pleases the king, let a decree be issued to destroy them. And I will give 10,000 talents of silver to the king's administrators for the royal treasury." So the king took his signet ring from his finger and gave it to Haman, son of Hammedatha, the Agagite, the enemy of the Jews. "Keep the money," the king said to Haman, "and do with the people as you please." Then on the 13th day of the first month, the royal secretaries were summoned. They wrote out in the script of each province and in the language of each people all Haman's orders to the king's satraps, the governors of the various provinces, and the nobles of the various peoples. These were written in the name of King Xerxes himself and sealed with his own ring. Dispatches were sent by couriers to all the king's provinces with the orders to destroy, kill, and annihilate all the Jews, young and old, women and children, on a single day, the 13th day of the 12th month, the month of Adar, and to plunder their goods. A copy of the text of the edict was to be issued as law in every province and made known to the people of every nationality so that they would be ready for the day. The couriers went out, spurred on by the king's command, and the edict was issued in the citadel of Susa. The king and Haman sat down to drink, but the city of Susa was bewildered. Father, we ask that you would give us insight into your word and how it speaks to us today. There is nothing in your word that does not reach out across the generations and touch the human heart and speak into the situations we face now. So, Lord, we pray that you would open our eyes to see and our ears to hear. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, in Esther chapter 2, we looked at what Scripture has to teach us when we are forced to make a decision between two bad choices. Esther was forced into the king's harem. She literally had no choice. All that was left to her in that situation was to either go along with it to see how the Lord might use her for his purposes and his glory, or to resist the circumstances she found herself in, knowing that to do so might make her feel better about herself, but would also eliminate any opportunity for God to use her. Now, it might seem at first glance that Mordecai, Esther's uncle, finds himself in a similar situation here in chapter 3. King Xerxes required every citizen of Persia to kneel in the presence of Haman, his newly appointed royal official, second only to Xerxes himself. No choice, right? But the fact is, the citizens of Persia were not physically forced to their knees, as Esther had been physically removed from her home and family. There was a choice. The question for Mordecai then became one of choosing to obey or disobey the king's command to kneel before Haman as a sign of honor. Up until this point, Mordecai had been a paragon of loyalty as a Persian citizen, giving honor and obedience to a government that had no love for the Jewish people. This was still a matter of choosing between two bad choices, only this time there really was a choice to make.
whereas for Esther, there was not. Mordecai's decision to disobey the government emerged from primary loyalty to God and from his obedience to God's word. Here's our takeaway. You're going to hear it a couple of different ways this morning. We are to give honor where honor is due, not when it contradicts our loyalty to God and obedience to his word. So let's unpack this a little bit. Take a look with me at verses 1 through 6. Where we've got an example of honor that is undeserved, and we're going to be looking specifically at Haman the Agagite. Now, Mordecai's decision to disobey the edict, to bow before Haman, was based on one thing and one thing only. Haman was an Agagite. And if I were to ask for a show of hands of those who know what an Agagite is, I can tell you it's not a disease. Haman was a descendant of Agag, the king of the Amalekites during the time of the Exodus. The Amalekites tried to prevent Moses from bringing the Hebrew people into the promised land. They sent an army against God's people in the wilderness. Now, Joshua eventually defeated the Amalekite army, but the Amalekites remained determined to prevent Abraham and his descendants from enjoying and entering the promised land. So following Joshua's victory over the Amalekite army, the scripture says this in Deuteronomy 25. This is God speaking to Moses. Remember what the Amalekites did to you along the way when you came out of Egypt. When you were weary and worn out, they met you on your journey and attacked all who were lagging behind. They had no fear of God. When the Lord your God gives you rest from all the enemies around you in the land he is giving you to possess as an inheritance, you shall blot out the name of Amalek from under heaven. Do not forget. Well, the Amalekites were not completely eradicated from the promised land during Joshua's conquest of Canaan. They continued to live on as a continual threat in Israel's midst. Saul, Israel's first king, finally had an opportunity to deal with the Amalekites once and for all. But for selfish purposes, Saul did not completely eliminate the Amalekites from Israel when he had the chance. Instead, for personal preferences, he kept the king alive. He took a lot of their possessions for himself. And God treated that as an act of rebellion, and it cost King Saul his rule as king over Israel. It says in 1 Samuel 15:23, "For rebellion is like the sin of divination, and arrogance like the evil of idolatry. Because," he's speaking to Saul directly, "because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he has rejected you as king." Well, Mordecai was not about to repeat Saul's mistake. He was not going to show any honor to a man whose mission in life was to destroy the people of God. Saul's failure ended up being a constant threat to Israel for generations. In Mordecai's day, even with the people of Israel in captivity in Persia, the Amalekite people also survived as a subculture in Persia, and their determination to exterminate the Jewish people never abated. Folks, this is a reminder. This isn't just a history lesson. This is a reminder of what happens in the believer's life when sin from the old nature is allowed to remain in even the smallest degree. Sin will destroy you if you let it survive. Hidden sin will eventually come to the surface and make a ruin of all the victory the Lord has otherwise had in the believer's life. The Bible compares sin in the believer's life that has not been crucified with Christ, but has been allowed to live on in a secret corner, as compared to like the sin of adultery. By entertaining sin, the believer is cheating on God.
And in the end, it is the believer who suffers the consequences. The Bible's warnings against the dangers of adultery apply to spiritual adultery as well. It says in Proverbs chapter 5, verses 8 through 10, listen carefully to this, keep a path far from her, meaning the adulterer. Do not go near the door of her house, lest you lose your honor to others and your dignity to one who is cruel. Lest strangers feast on your wealth and your toil enrich the house of another. Powerful words. Lest you lose your honor to others and your dignity to one who is cruel. There was a reason Mordecai had forbidden Esther to reveal her Jewish identity. He knew there were powerful people in places of influence in the king's court who were anti-Semitic with a vengeance. Haman was among them. It was dangerous to be a Jew who lived as a Jew, not as a Persian. Day after day, it says in verse 4, they spoke to him, but he refused to comply. Therefore, they told Haman about it to see whether Mordecai's behavior would be tolerated. For he told them he was a Jew. Mordecai was not about to kneel before Haman as a representative of the group that wanted Jews scraped off the face of the earth. Now, some say that Mordecai's refusal to kneel before Haman was a matter of ego. After all, kneeling in the presence of royalty and people deserving of honor was both customary and biblical. Abraham bowed before the Hittites in the land of Canaan, Genesis 23, verse 7. And in 1 Samuel 24, verse 8, David, as a young man before he was king, fleeing for his life from King Saul, who had gone absolutely nuts, David bowed before Saul out of respect for the role he carried as the king of Israel, God's anointed. So this was not a matter of arrogant pride on Mordecai's part. Mordecai knew of Haman's Amalekite heritage. That's why, in verse 4, when challenged for not bowing before Haman, Mordecai revealed that he was a Jew. That was the reason he wouldn't do it. That confession brought out Haman's true colors, as we see in verses 5 through 6. When Haman saw Mordecai would not kneel down to pay honor to him, he was enraged. And yet, having learned of Mordecai's background, his heritage, his people were, he scorned the idea of killing just Mordecai. Instead, he looked for a way to destroy all of Mordecai's people, the Jews, throughout the whole kingdom of Xerxes. Kneeling before Haman would be honor undeserved. Mordecai was going to do it. Take a look at verses 7 through 11, where it moves from undeserved honor to the abuse of honor. In verse 7 it says, in the 12th year of King Xerxes, in the first month, the month of Nisan, the pur, that is the lot, was cast. Why is that important? These details, a little side note here, especially for those who question the historicity of the Bible. Throughout this, you have month and day and year and place and time, historical anchors, if you will. God wants you to know this is rooted in history. This wasn't some made-up children's story or myth. This took place in the 12th year of King Xerxes, in the first month, the month of Nisan. And the lot was cast. Now, all of those details tell us that 5 years had gone by since Esther was made queen of Persia. And until now, Esther's Jewish heritage had remained undisclosed, and frankly, it was a non-issue. But now that Mordecai revealed his Jewish heritage, Haman realized Esther was Jewish as well, the queen of Persia. And it seems that when Haman and his fellow conspirators cast lots in the first month of the year, the purpose was to determine when the plot to systematically annihilate every Jew in Persia would be presented to the king for his approval. That date ended up being almost a year later. And the lot fell on the 12th month, the month of Adar, as we see in verse 7. So now, 11 months later, Haman uses his position of honor to deceive the king. He uses his position of honor to deceive the king, telling him only of a certain people living throughout Persia who deserve to be eradicated from the population. He doesn't name the people group. He just lists the offenses that are worthy of this radical measure. Look at this. They keep themselves separate. Their customs are different. And they do not obey the king's laws. And for these reasons, Haman concludes in verse 8, it is not in the king's best interest to tolerate them. Now, the only one of these accusations that actually had any merit in the Persian legal system was the charge of not obeying the king's laws. That charge was based solely on one man's refusal to kneel before Haman. And yet Haman presented it to the king as if an entire ethnic group was in active treasonous rebellion against the king. You ever heard of such charges like this before against ethnic groups or religious groups in our country? They are different. They keep themselves separate. Look how easy it is to turn people who are different from ourselves into enemies. And look how easy it is for those in positions of political influence and power to create laws that isolate those who are different and make it sound reasonable to remove such people from the population. But the issue immediately in front of us is how Haman abused the honor and the position of authority King Xerxes had entrusted to him, and how Mordecai chose to expose that abuse of honor by exposing his own loyalty to God above his loyalty to Haman, or even the king. As the Apostle Paul responded in the book of Acts, the Apostle Peter responded in the book of Acts when told to preach no more in Jesus' name, Acts 5:29, Peter and the other apostles replied, "We must obey God rather than beings." That's the position Mordecai found himself in. Human beings are weak, but spirit-filled human beings are able to do above and beyond what the frail human nature thinks possible. Haman abused the honor bestowed upon him by King Xerxes. He abused it by using that position of honor to deceive the very man who had bestowed such honor upon him. He abused his position of honor by using it to establish a political movement of hatred in the pursuit of his own personal vendetta against the people of God. It was Haman, not Mordecai, who yielded to ego and pride, abusing the honor given him. And it is Mordecai, not Haman, to whom honor is due for remaining loyal to God and obedient to God's word. When you honor the Lord by remaining loyal and obedient to him in the face of political and social pressure, God will honor you. James chapter 1, verse 12. Blessed is the one who perseveres under trial, because having stood the test, that person will receive the crown of life that the Lord has promised to those who love him. And not only the crown of life, eternal life in Christ, as if that were not enough, but also the crown of glory. You who remain faithful will not only live in God's eternal kingdom, but you will shine for all the created universe to see as the resurrected children of God who rule and reign over creation at Christ's right hand. 1 Peter 5:4 says, and when the chief shepherd, meaning Jesus, when the chief shepherd appears, that moment he appears in the heavens, you will receive the crown of glory that will never fade away. Finally, take a look at verses 12 to the end of the chapter, where now this degradation of honor moves to the absence of honor. It says in verse 12, that on the 13th day of the first month, the royal secretaries were summoned. It took a couple of weeks after Haman's plan was accepted by the king for the administrative wheels to start turning. But once they started, there seemed to be no turning back. When someone undeserving of honor abuses their position of honor, what naturally follows is a total absence of honor. It is a cascading effect. Do not expect people in power who are undeserving of honor, who then abuse their position for personal gain, do not expect them to do something honorable. Honor undeserved and abused always leads to an absence of honor. The book of Proverbs puts it this way. You're going to have to get your mental imagination working here. Picture trying to throw a stone with a slingshot. Proverbs 26 verse 8 says, like tying a stone in a sling, tying a stone into the sling is the giving of honor to a fool. You can whip that thing all day long, the stone's never going to leave the sling. But look at this. No one dared to step in and challenge Haman's horrendous act of genocide that was about to take place. The royal secretaries wrote out Haman's instructions with the order to destroy, kill, and annihilate all the Jews, young and old, women and children, on a single day, and to plunder their goods, verse 13. And they wrote it out in the script and language of the Persian Empire's 20 provinces, and no one stood up to object. Haman's diabolical plan, written in the name of King Xerxes himself and sealed with Xerxes' own ring in verse 12, was sent by courier to the king's satraps. That's 20 men who ruled over the 20 provinces, and not one of them objected. The government mandate was sent next to the governors within those provinces, and not one of the governors objected. The governors passed the mandate on to the nobles, the landowners, the community officials of the various local communities, and not one of them objected. The Persian government authorities didn't even attempt to hide the plan from the general public. Instead, a copy was issued as law and made known to the people of every nationality so they would be ready for the day, verse 14, and still no one objected. People were stunned. They were bewildered, as it says in verse 15, but no one of honor raised his voice to say, this is wrong. Meanwhile, satisfied that the treasonous rebellion was cut off at the roots before it could spread, verse 15 tells us the king and Haman sat down to drink. During World War II, 6 million Jews and another 4 million people viewed by the Nazi Party as being biologically, racially, or religiously inferior, including the Roma people, who we know as the Gypsies, the Polish people, the Russians, Blacks, Jehovah's Witnesses, the list goes on and on. They were systematically ostracized by a government for being different. And then they were systematically murdered. World War II seems like a long ways away. And we tell ourselves the human race has evolved and matured since then. Think again. Worldwide, today, At least 90,000 believers in Jesus Christ annually are murdered because of their faith. 90,000 a year. Here in the U.S., mostly insulated from that level of overt hatred,
followers of Jesus are nevertheless routinely characterized as different and countercultural. Folks, that's not a bad thing. The kingdom of God is by nature countercultural. And we are citizens of God's kingdom first, earthly kingdoms second. But understand this. Do not expect to be treated honorably by people who are undeserving of the honor of the political or influential positions they hold. Your responsibility and mine at such times as this is simply, as followers of Jesus Christ, give honor where honor is due. Unashamedly, give honor where honor is due, but never when it contradicts our loyalty and our obedience to God. Is there an amen out there? Amen. Heavenly Father, I pray that you would make of your people a people of the Spirit, a people of the Word, and a people of courage. A Mordecai kind of people. That you would give us, as we heard at the beginning of this service, you would give us the awareness of your will because we are grounded in your word. Make us a people of your word. We confess, we acknowledge, Lord God, our weakness, our spiritual laziness in digging into your word and letting it inform us and transform us and transfigure us. Lord, we need to operate under the mind of Christ. So it is my prayer that you would train us as a people to push away the things that would push us away from you and that would push us away from you. That you would give us a thirst, that you make us famished for the light of your word. That we would soak it up and it would engage us at the emotional level, the spiritual level, the mental level, so that it pours out of us in our behavior and our responses when we are challenged, as Mordecai was challenged. Our desire, as followers of Jesus, is to give honor where honor is due, but to have the boldness in your spirit, never give honor when it contradicts our loyalty and our obedience to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let's stand together as we sing our closing song, Raise a Hallelujah.
I raise a hallelujah.
people of courage. Be strong. Do everything in love. The grace of the Lord Jesus be with you all. And God's people said,
amen.
Let's raise a hallelujah.
Hallelujah.